The word, if it's not a lamp to the feet and the light to the path, it means nothing. Simple as that. If the word is not the desire of the heart, it means nothing. Doesn't matter how many scripture verses you can quote. A love for the word, an affection for the word. Jesus said in John 14, 23, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. Turn to Matthew chapter 7. Hold your place in James, but turn to Matthew chapter 7. Hold your place in James. Turn to Matthew 7. And I want you to go to verse 24. Matthew 7, verse 24. Jesus gives one of the most, I would say it's one of his most popular statements because it's used by a lot of people in a lot of different contexts. He says in verse 24, everyone who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house upon a rock. The rain fell, the floods came, the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like the foolish man who built his house on the sand. The rain fell, the floods came, the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Notice what he says here. He says that many people say they are believers. Their words are just words. They do not have a foundation in belief in His Word so much so that it becomes an application. They have not built upon the foundation of His Word. He said, a lot of people say that Jesus said, whoever builds their foundation on me. That's not what He said. He said, whoever builds the foundation on my Word. The church that is not founded on the Word of God will not stand as a church. The house that is not built on the Word of God will not stand as a house. And the life that is not built on the Word of God will not stand as a life in eternity. It may be very prosperous in this age, but it will go into eternity in the fires of hell. We must be founded on the Word of God. We must have our foundation in the Word of God. Jesus said, the wise person builds the house on my words. Getting back now to James. As I said, in this section, James deals with the genuine desires of the person, with the genuine response of the word of a person. And he shows us that one of the most reliable ways we can tell if our faith is genuine is how we respond to the word of God. And I have given you three points in your worship folder this morning. I gave you an outline of three points. Three things that I want you to note from James's words. Three distinct tests regarding the word that we need to recognize. The first one is the attitude of the brethren, which is submission to the word. Read with me again verse 19. Know this, my brothers, my beloved brothers. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your soul. Notice the three imperatives that he gives. Three things he says about the word. He said there's three ways that we ought to really focus on. What three are they? We need to be quick to hear. We need to be slow to speak, and we need to be slow to anger. Let's break those down very quickly. What does it mean to be quick to hear? Well, to be quick to hear might better be translated, we need to be diligent to listen. That's what that means. When he says you need to be quick to hear, it means you need to be diligent to listen to the word. We need to exercise these things God gave us. I oftentimes tell the children in my class that I teach on Thursday nights, God gave you two of these and only one of these so that you could use these twice as much as you use this. Because you're so much better off if you're listening than you are if you're speaking. By listening, we learn. By listening, we receive. By listening, we begin to discern, to hear good and receive good, to hear bad and put it out. We begin to exercise the discerning quality of our brain. Through our listening, we take in the truth. But oftentimes through our speaking, we are simply in error. There's an old phrase, and I know many of you have heard it, and I hope I get it right. It's better to remain quiet and to be thought a fool than to open your mouth and remove all doubt. Is that right? Better to just be quiet and be thought a fool than to open your mouth. This is what the Bible says about being quiet in Proverbs. You know, Proverbs is all about practical stuff. Practical wisdom. Proverbs says this, Proverbs 17:28. Says, even a fool is counted wise when he holds his peace. When he shuts his lips, he is considered perceptive. Better to just be quiet. Better to listen and take in. To not have something to say about everything, but simply receive what others are saying. Be quick to hear and diligent in our hearing. And then he says, he accompanies that with the other side of the coin. He says, be quick to hear and be slow to speak. Of course, as I said, that's just the sister to listening well, is being slow to speak. You can't talk and listen at the same time. That's something else you got to explain to children sometimes, is they'll both be talking to each other and neither one will stop. You got to stop at some point and let the other person get a word in edgewise. To be a good student of the Word means that you are slow, you allow it to be taught, and you are slow to speak in the sense that you allow it to speak more than you do. But even further than just simply being slow to speak, there's something about slowness of speech that James is trying to get across. He's trying to get across the idea of thoughtful speech. Just like when he says, be quick to hear, he's talking about intentional hearing, about hearing that is discerning, hearing that is focused. So in his slowness of speech, he's saying, be slow to speak in the sense that you consider your words. How many people do you know that are very quick to speak and don't care what they say? Don't you think that the world would be so much better off if we would all take a second before we say some of the things that we say and consider how they're going to affect someone else? To be slow in our speech rather than just simply be quick to say the first thing that comes to our mind? You know how terrible of a world it would be in if we all just said the first thing that came to our mind all the time? Nobody would have any friends if we all just quickly said the first thing that jumps into our mind all the time. James says, be slow to speak. Consider your words. And if you focus this upon the context, the overriding context here is the Word of God, I think that there's something that he's trying to get across to us, and that is slowness is should absolutely be used if you are a person who is talking about the Word of God. Especially if you're a teacher of the Word of God. People say, Pastor, why do you bring 10 pages of notes into the pulpit? You could get up there and talk for 2 hours without one note. I say, yes, I absolutely could. But you know what? I am considering every word I say. Because the Bible tells me in 2 Timothy 2:15, do your best to present yourself as a workman that is not ashamed, who is rightly dividing the word of truth. Do your best to rightly teach the Word. Discernment in your speech. Focus in your speech. We have a responsibility, and I more so than others, because the Bible says in James, this very same book, that teachers are judged even more strictly. That teachers are judged at a higher standard. Why? Because we've been called to teach. And we have to discern every word that we say. Speaking properly about the Word is so important. And it takes time. We have to be discerning. We have to be focused. We ought not just simply ramble.